Hello, this is Peter Combs from Bidamount.com, and today is January 27th, 2016. We haven't done a video in a while. We've been kind of busy doing some other things and traveling and whatnot. But I had one in mind a while ago that I wanted to do on Chinese copper redwares and a little bit of the history on them, where the Chinese learned to do this. And copper redwares, as many of you know, are often referred to the resulting pieces later were called Peachbloom and Sang de Boeuf and Lang Yao and all that. It all comes from the use of copper and copper oxides in pottery and porcelain. And you have pieces like this in the palace collection, but in the National Gallery in Washington, D.C. They have a huge collection in the basement there that's on display all the time. It's well worth a visit. All right. As I said a few seconds ago, the copper red really started, it had its origins in the Middle East, in Mesopotamia in particular, about 3,000 years before the Chinese were even aware of it. It's interesting how cobalt and now this had their roots in the Middle East with the potters there. But they didn't make porcelain at that time. They didn't know how. At that time, they made mostly stonewares, and they used an awful lot of copper. They really laid it on heavy percentages to produce sort of a greenish result. Later, the Egyptians in the second millennia BC began applying it to glass and glass making, and got some really tremendous results if you've ever looked at Egyptian glass and how skilled they were at it. Around the Warring States period, copper as a coloring agent found its way into China. And it was used mostly back then. It was only on pottery, and it produced sort of dense green colors to the pieces. And then by the 15th century, they brought it back, and it became a very popular color on ritual vases. And this was sort of really the high water mark of copper red as far as perfection goes. They made them in very small numbers, copper red stem cups and whatnot. And then by the end of the Ming Dynasty, into the Qing Dynasty, especially during the Kangxi period, they brought back these colors. They brought back using copper red a great deal. And one of the ways it was applied often was with a color known as peach bloom. One fellow I know used to refer to it as peach blow. but at any rate, they had them on peach bloom pieces. And the classic peach bloom wares come in what are known as the eight basic shapes. Okay, there are eight for the scholar's table, and this is one of them. This vase is called a string vase. It was referred to that also by Michel Berthelet in his great book on Qing porcelain that he did years and years ago. And it's because of these three lines running around the neck. We can blow this up. All of these images are on the Metropolitan Museum website, by the way, and if you want to go there, you can enlarge them and play with them and look at them to your heart's content. All right, we'll try to add a link to that later on in the video. And here's the neck of the vase. Again, you get these three light lines where the glaze was thin, turned white, and you get a good look at the surface, the effects that can be had using copper red in the right atmosphere in a kiln by carefully controlling the temperatures and the amount of oxygen. You get these terrific effects. And we're going to run through a bunch of these. We've added on here. Okay, the next one is this one. Here we have another string vase, beautifully done. And here is a bigger zinnamphora vase. It's mounted on a later stand. The stand is not Chinese, just so you know. Okay, but this has a deep red. This is a deeper red model, and unfortunately, they over exposed the photograph on this rather terribly, but it's a beautiful, beautiful shape and a beautiful color. The Metropolitan in New York has a massive collection of these wares. Unfortunately, they don't put them on display as much as they should. Okay, and here you have the next one in their collection, another amphora vase. Again, now you have a more of a dry copper surface here, and you get this these lovely green effects caused also by the copper and the firing. And you can blow it up. Let's get inside the mouth. Let's pull it over here. There it is. All right. get a good look at the insides of the mouths of these, because there are a lot of fakes of these pieces floating around. A lot of them were made after the beginning of the 20th century, and they ended up in a lot of collections around the world because these were so much in demand among famous collectors of the day. And there just aren't that many real ones around, so they just started doing what they always do in China. They just kept making them. Started making them, and they made some awfully good copies. Here's another one. This is another amphora vase. This is a very different type of glaze. Much softer, very soft glaze on this. Beautiful color variations up around the shoulder and running up into the neck. And the body has a very symmetrically tapering base to it, down to this rather high unglazed foot, which is something you did see on these. And the marks, if you flip one of these over, a real one, the mark is heavily recessed up inside there. It's almost like a tube on the bottom on the amphora bases. Not so much on the others, though. All right. And here we have a brush coupe. They used to call these chicken coupes sometimes, because it was shaped like a Chinese chicken coop. But it was a popular form with a dragon incised into it. And again, you have all these terrific variations in color, all the way up to a near apple green up here under the neck, caused by the firing. Okay, these were not decorated this way. All these color variations occurred during the firing. And here is another brush, a water jar coupe. And we can blow this one up, zoom right in on it. And there you can see the incised decoration. It's partially obscured by the browning effect of the glaze when it fired. Covered it up, filled it in a bit, unfortunately. All right, it's a nice example. Unfortunately, it went through this. This is a much better example, obviously. It's beautifully done. The control of the glaze was much nicer. A nice shading from a fairly deep red on some areas down to pink to a sort of a tannish green. And then this nice apple green ring around the neck. And then splotches of red inside the mouth. All right. And if we move in closely to this, you can see the bubbles rather clearly, especially in the areas where it was carved. And the glaze ran a little bit thicker. And the bubbles were able to form. But very nicely done. All the way down, and as is classic with these pieces, again, the glaze goes to a little white lip and stops neatly above the foot. Something you want to see on these, okay? This is an extremely rare form. They all are extremely rare, so if you've come across one, very possibly it's a later example. Here's a seal paste box, one of the 8 official forms also. And again, you see here this apple green and the copper oxide and the fire from the firing and the red on top. All right. There's some excellent papers written on these pieces, by the way. One of them is called Chinese Copper Redwares. The Percival David Foundation put it out a number of years ago in a monograph series they did. This, I believe, this one was monograph number 3. And it has a long introduction, a long section written by Nigel Wood, who's a renowned expert on glazes and the chemistry of glazes, if you really want to get into it. You almost need a chemistry degree to understand what he's talking about, but he does cover quite a bit of the history of it as well. He's a wonderful writer, lives in the UK. And here you have the, let's zoom up on this a bit. Again, you're going to see also in some of these some crackles sometime. Now here's a crackle here, and you'll see crackles in the glazes of these pieces because they liked crackles, okay? And then you have these very, very dark greenish, almost black spots that were formed when the piece was fired. And here's another box, another seal paste box with the same sort of variations in color that we saw in the last. Not quite as dramatic, though. The green spots are a little less. But again, another very, very fine box. And here's another box, probably the prettiest of them all, on a lovely, it looks to be an ivory stand. It could also be some sort of bleached wood. They didn't say in the catalog entry what it was, but a beautifully done stand with this elegant little paste box sitting on top. And then we'll move over. Here's another type that you could encounter in a museum. Is a piece where the red is fairly sparse. It's just sort of on the top and around the rim where the box is put together. And the rest of the green is the result of copper oxide. And it turned a very, very soft, lighter than celery green, a very soft color. And here we have, these are called lotus petal vases, one of the official eight. And for the obvious reason that the base has these incised lotus leaf lappets running around it. And this, notice the slightly shaped base on which they sit, on which it sits. And then this very, very tidy line where the glaze is forced to end. All right. And there's the mouth of the vase with this nice, neat white area around the top. It's quite good. And here we have another lotus vase. This one, obviously, is much more pink in color than the previous. Virtually identical in shape, though. Virtually identical. But again, a very different effect to the glaze. This is extremely soft, these darker red, and again, the lotus leaves at the bottom. And now we have this. These are one of my favorite shapes. They call these apple form brush pots, brush coupes. And it looks like an apple. It's compressed around the top and is just absolutely elegantly done. And this is used as a vase. Some people say that they were used to dip, as a brush, as a water pot. So you can, depends on who you listen to. I think probably it's a vase. And this is one of the rarest of all the eight forms, I think. You just don't see them. These are called coiled dragon vases. And it was obviously for a flower. These are all fairly small. This vase is only about 8 or 9 inches tall, with a dragon wrapped around the neck in green glaze. And what's wonderful about this vase is that it's got so much going on with the glaze, because the glaze on this was pretty thickly potted. And you notice it has the crackles running a twisting motion sort of around the body. And it starts at this nice soft pink and then darkens up as it moves down. And when you get into the shoulder of it, it's important to look at the characteristics of these. You'll see the irregular crackles running all over the place. It's like a little circus of cracks. Up over the shoulder, again, you get this nice green effect here in the middle, and then it pools off and gets lighter and lighter as it travels up. And here are the crackles and the bubbles. A little bit about bubbles. Later copies, if you magnify bubbles, they tend to be extremely uniform on the copies. There's not much irregularity to the pattern. On older pieces, if you magnify them, the bubbles are all different sizes. There's no regularity really to them at all. But if you look at a piece up under a good magnification, and you see the bubbles are very neat and orderly, it indicates it was made in a modern environment. All right. And there's the base. You can see how the copper red creeped into the cracks a little bit and darkened them. And it's a lovely piece. It's one of my favorites. All right. And then we click out of there and we come back. This is not one of the official eight. This is just a rather nice copper red 18th century piece, done well, nicely potted. And I just wanted to use it as comparison. Again, if you move in closely on this, you see an awful lot of little pits on these. You do see these on 18th century pieces. Not the very finest ones. The really fine ones are perfectly smooth. But this is sort of a production piece, I would guess. Probably made around the end of the Kangxi period. Again, you have this very nicely finished, nice neat finish on the foot where the glaze stops above it. It was a skill they had. They lost it eventually. By the 19th century, glazes often ran over the foot, and the potters would be sort of rip them off the floor, the sagers are off the kiln, and then have to grind it down in order to make the thing stand straight and be presentable. All right. If you see ground red running over a foot, it's probably late 18th or well into the 19th century. And again, you see where the glaze ran thin, turns white. And here's another one. This is a bowl. This is a very pretty bowl in the Met collection with an applied copper rim to protect it. And this sort of what they refer to sometimes to crushed strawberries is the color they call it. Beautifully done, lovely shape to the bowl. It's based on an earlier shape on a Ming shape, but it's an 18th century Kangxi period bowl. And we can move in on this fortunately and take a good look at that foot rim to really see the characteristics of it. Notice how the red glaze tapers off to white and creates that little white drape before it goes to the unglazed portion of the paste itself. And you can see here, you can even see here the when they turned the bowl, how they smoothed it out. You can see the lines from the tools that were used to smooth the bowl's foot rim out. All right. And here we have an 18th century Kangxi period Meiping vase, a more standard production piece. This is something you could find at a local auction. Rather nice Meiping. Not as carefully done as the Peachbloom pieces, obviously. It's not a Peachbloom glaze, but it's a nice iron red color. And lastly, we come to this. I just wanted to show this because they often say that Peachbloom only existed on the official in the official forms in the 18th century, that they didn't apply Peachbloom to other pieces. Well, here's a little beaker vase, and there are other known examples. This one's in the Met collection, that has a Peachbloom vase or glaze on it. It's clearly that's what it is, and they applied it to this little beaker vase. It's not a terribly well potted piece, but it's a good example of something that you could find, out and around. All right, so don't overlook it if you see one. It's quite valuable and fairly rare nonetheless. And again, you see this very neat, the red glaze runs down, turns a little white around the edge, and then stops, revealing this rather nice foot on it. All right. And you'll often see Chinese paintings where they used monochromes in them, and other colors too. You'll see paintings like this. This is a painting in the Met collection that was done in the 19th century. But this is clearly 18th century pieces. Let's pull this vase over here. The artist did a pretty good job. It's got a blue flambe glaze on the inside and a red glaze on the outside. Generally, when you see this kind of mix, you're looking at often at a Qin Lung period piece made in the middle of the latter part of the 18th century. And then you have another piece of flambe glaze here on this rather wildly shaped bronze-formed porcelain. It's shaped like a bronze, but it's actually porcelain. And this shape also is popular in Japan. And you have these ring handles. That's a Chinese one. And then on the table, further over, you have the classic crackleware 18th century vase, nice Yixing teapot, and a rather attractive covered blue and white bowl sitting in its little cozy on top of a rather exceptional Chinese table. All right, so that wraps it up. I hope we've covered the things you might be interested in on this. And to learn more, visit our website, sign up, get our newsletter. It's free. And we try to keep track of things that are on the web. And we'll do some more videos later. Thanks for stopping in. Have a great day. Bye-bye.